Good evening, everyone. So today, the Regional Institute of Education is going to organize the Youth Parliament. And on this wonderful evening, I would like Honorable Principal Professor P.C. Agarwal, sir, esteemed Dean of Instruction Professor S.K. Das, sir, and Program Coordinator Dr. Kalinga Ketki, sir, to light the lamp. Now I would like Program Coordinator Dr. Kalinga Ketki, sir, to present the bouquet to Honorable Principal Professor P.C. Agarwal, sir, and esteemed Dean of Instruction Professor S.K. Das, sir. Now I would like Program Coordinator Dr. Kalinga Ketki, sir, to present the welcome address.
Good evening to one and all. Namaskar. Honorable Principal Professor P.C. Agarwal, sir. Sir, I welcome you in this great occasion. And it is the first time, I think, with the inspiration of our honorable principal sir, I could able to organize this youth parliament in the history of RI for the first time. So thank you for your constant inspiration and advice to conduct this kind of program. Then I would like to welcome none other than esteemed Dean of Instructions, Professor S.K. Das sir, in this program. Sir is also a source of inspiration. He always giving me very good piece of advice, and he also suggested so many times that you have this kind of program in this institute. Sir, I welcome you in this program, and I welcome all the faculty members. I welcome Dr. Dhanya Krishnan ma'am. I welcome Dr. Rashmi Rekha ma'am, and I welcome all my young faculty sitting before me, and I welcome all the students in this program. Dear friends, this youth parliament is not a new concept in Indian education system, and especially it is new in RI Bhubaneswar, because as far as my knowledge concerned, I don't know that whether this youth parliament was conducted in this institute or not, but I'm sure that it was not conducted earlier. This is the first time we are conducting this youth parliament by the strong inspirations and support of our esteemed principal, Professor P.C. Agrawal sir. So thank you once again. Dear friends, having this youth parliament, we are having lot of logic. Due to shortage of time, I'm not going to elaborate many things, because I'm a man of political science. I could, but the thing is, due to the restrictions of time, because Principal sir is highly, highly, highly busy due to this Kala Utsav program, which is coming on 3rd of January 2023. And SKD sir also busy, and you also busy in some other activities. This youth parliament we are organizing to simulate the proceedings of the parliament. And you know that parliament is the highest law-making body in our country. Every democratic country, whether it may be direct or indirect, it may be that is called representative democracy or participatory democracy, we will have to have a constitution. We are having two types of constitution. One is written constitution, another one is unwritten constitution. The unwritten constitution example is United Kingdom constitution, which is purely unwritten. And you know that Indian constitution is the longest serving constitution in the world. And all this we are having, and this parliament, which is the law of the land. And we are organizing this kind of activities because the student can able to know the proceedings of the parliament, how the law is to prepare, how the law will have to pass, how the bill will have to prepare, and entire proceedings of the parliament, how the ruling party and the opposition party, they are fighting on different bills, to pass different bills. The thing is, if you'll discuss, if you'll have this kind of youth parliament, then all the students can able to know the real activities of the government, and they can also aware about the public issues. And this can give a different kind of challenge to the government to do the rightful thing, which is very, very essential for the social or national development process. And especially in the nation building process, you know that all the citizens, they are having very important role. And if you could able to know the social issues, then you can give information or knowledge to the people concerned, and we can able to have a good system under which we can work or we can live. So this is the objective of this youth parliament. The students of RI Bhubaneswar, they have worked a lot. They have worked for last couple of days, could be around 15 days. And I think, I hope that they have prepared very nicely. And today we are going to have this parliament session here in this RI stage, which will be the replica of our parliament. And I wish all the best to all the participants. And I once again welcome all the students and principal sir and Dean I to this program. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Now I would like Dean of Instructions, Professor S.K. Das sir, to address the audience.
Esteemed Principal Professor P.C. Agrawalji, coordinator of this program, Dr. Kalinga Ketki, Lord and faculty members of our institute, and my dear students. First of all, I would like to appreciate the initiation made by our principal in this regard, because I had been hearing that this youth parliament would be there in our institute, and from the principal, Professor P.C. Agrawal sir, and he was motivating Dr. Kalinga Ketki that you please take initiation and start, as because our students have huge potential. So that potential I cannot measure, but in my opinion it is infinite level of potential a student have. If you get the platform and if you get the right order of motivation, one day you will be positively showing your talent and showing your potential, and you will show the light before the country. The country is waiting for you all. And you know that India is the largest democratic country of the world, and we know the value of democracy, and we should understand deeply, directly or indirectly, by involving ourselves in this type of discussion. That's why Dr. Kalinga Ketki took the right order of initiation, and he has arranged this particular kind of youth parliament in this auditorium today. I also congratulate this particular kind of venture made by Dr. Kalinga Ketki. And students, I understand lot of dreams are there in your mind. I can read your eyes. I can understand your thoughts. And I know whenever you are working at some level, the full level of potential you are utilizing and trying your level best to put all your efforts so that your activities would be at the top. And I also appreciate you all. I know you will do the best. And once again, I appreciate you all. I congratulate you all. And I thank you all. You please join very intrinsically and very significantly and understand what is the power of democracy. Once again, I repeat, what is the power of democracy? If you understand the power of democracy, one day you will make use of that power. Who knows, at some days you will be a member of parliament, at some days you will be the minister, at some days you will be the prime minister even, you will be the president even, because this is democracy. So in that way, you please, be open-minded, because you are knowledgeable, you are talented. Knowledge is the power, and this particular kind of democracy is the power. integrate both the things, knowledge as a power and democracy as a power. Then think yourself, what would be your role and how you lead the country, how you lead yourself, so that India will see different kind of, I mean, level. So as you people dream today. So with these words, I conclude. Thank you all. Thank you.
Now I would like to call Honorable Principal Professor P.C. Agarwal, sir, to address the audience.
Good afternoon, namaskar. Esteemed Professor S.K. Dasji, Dean of Instruction, Dr. Ketki ji, Program Coordinator, my learned colleagues and dear students. As we all know that India is the biggest democratic country and democracy is its power. We all know that our constitution is a very large document, written document, and it took 2 years, 11 months and 18 days. And the good things, the best practices of all the constitutions we have incorporated, including Irish constitution or Britain constitution or American constitution. And we are exercising those things. And that's why we say that our country is rightly observing the democracy. We all know that there are two houses in parliament, upper house, Rajya Sabha, lower house, Lok Sabha, and how the elections take place, I think you know, direct or indirect, in terms of Lok Sabha or Rajya Sabha. Rajya Sabha is direct election or indirect election? Then how the value of the vote is calculated. So there are so many things, and I had an opportunity last year, December only, to visit Lok Sabha Speaker's House as well as Parliament. I have photos also I have shown him. And fortunately, he is known to me. And fortunately, Rajya Sabha President is also known to me because we are from the same college alumni, Maharaja's College, Jaipur. Sri Jagdeep Dhankar ji, who was sometime before Governor West Bengal. So I have seen the Parliament. In Parliament, there are red carpet and red seats and green carpet and green seats. One house belongs to red seat, red, everything red. Means, and Rajya Sabha member cannot sit on Lok Sabha member's seat. There is some punishment and penalty also. So how the proceeding takes place, I have seen very closely. And we all know that these parties are based on ideologies, as we say. Otherwise, they are very good friends. That time, in December last, this year, sorry, last year 21, 5 or 10 MPs were expelled from the house. They were even sitting on the agitation there. Most of them were TMC MPs, Trinamool Congress MPs. So how our parliament is working, that we should see. How many committees are there, you know, standing committee, joint parliamentary committee, finance committee. In some committees, only opposition has to chair the committee. In some committees, government, pro-government MP has to chair. You all know that without any election, even one can become prime minister for some time. Then within 6 months, one has to get elected. So what is the way, how we can elect, and after election, what are our duties, what is the role of our opposition leader? Even in my school days, we have done, you would have done also, that in schools we had students elections. I was in one time, I was prime minister of that union, while other time I was leader of opposition. Even in universities, colleges, we have come through all those phases. So we know what are the rights, what are the duties. Only rights are not important. And how the things are placed on the table in parliament, that is very important. How argumentation is there, what is zero time, this time, that, many proceedings are there. You can understand question hour, what is the question hour. Some assemblies, they limit question hour, question time. So how the proceedings takes place, how the things are prioritized, how questions are placed, how answers are given. When parliament session is there, all the central government offices are asked not to allow anyone on leave. And if some question comes, even our institute, we have to reply immediately with all full data. So there one cannot speak lie. The thing should be evidenced by data. And any type of question can be asked, which is within the constitutional limit. So many things are there. We can understand only when we exercise. And here I'm observing that all the students, they have prepared well. How they will do that, we will see later on. But now they are sitting, ministers are there. So I think parliament is already constituted and ministry is there. And cabinet ministry has a special power, you know. There are many types of ministers, minister of independent state minister, minister of state, deputy minister. And cabinet is the most powerful executive in our country. We all know that parliament means executive, how execution of the law is taken place. Law is constructed, is formulated in parliament through bureaucrats, how executive works. And executive head is, I think, prime minister. So who is executive head? What is the role of president? We all should know. What is the role of Lok Sabha speaker? What is the role of vice president, who is Rajya Sabha chairperson? So all these things we can know better if the things are exercised before us. And how participation can be ensured, how dialogues are there, how things are placed, how things are supported, things are opposed, and what is the net result. So opposition should be very strong to check the monopoly of the government. At the same time, government should work with the will for social wellness, for national interest in larger sense. And I'll not take much time. Here, students, they have prepared well. I am very confident that they will do in a very perfect manner. And since this is a training type of thing, we can say later on they can become good parliamentarian, good minister. They can lead country. इन्हीं जगहों से बच्चे निकलते हैं, ऊपर से कहीं से कुछ नहीं आता है. तो हो सकता है यहाँ से भी कुछ बच्चे जाएं. सो वी शुड एक्सरसाइज द थिंग्स इन ए वेल मैनर. वी शुड अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट आर कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन गारंटीज, व्हाट आर आर राइट्स, एंड हाउ वी कैन गेट दोज राइट्स. एवरीवन हैज राइट टू नो एवरीथिंग. इवन टू डेज बिफोर दिस इंसिडेंट टुक प्लेस विद चाइना, एवरी अपोजिशन लीडर इज आस्किंग टू प्लेस ऑल द फैक्ट्स ऑन द टेबल. Mallikarjun Khadge ji, whether Adhiranjan Chaudhary, I think I am very interested in seeing all these things. आप भी देखते होंगे, मेरा तो ये इंटरेस्ट है. तो वो कैसे बात कर रहे हैं, कैसे प्रधानमंत्री से कह रहे हैं कि आप रखिए, राजनाथ सिंह क्या बोल रहे हैं, अमित शाह क्या बोल रहे हैं. सो हाउ दे आर डिफेंडिंग, हाउ द पॉलिटिक्स कम्स इनसाइड. व्हेन अमित शाह इज आंसरिंग, ही इज सेइंग कि नेहरू के टाइम पे काश्मीर का इतना पार्ट चला गया, चाइना ने 62 में ऐसे किया अटैक में. सो हाउ टू प्रोटेक्ट योरसेल्फ, हाउ टू ब्रिंग द अदर फेस, एंड हाउ टू आर्ग्यू, ऑल दीज थिंग्स वी कैन अंडरस्टैंड दैट व्हाट इज हैपनिंग इन पार्लियामेंट. आई विल नॉट टेक मच टाइम. आई थैंक डॉक्टर कलिंगा कीर्ति जी, ही टू कीन इंटरेस्ट फॉर ऑर्गेनाइजिंग दिस यूथ पार्लियामेंट. एंड एज ही अश्योर्ड मी, स्टूडेंट्स हैव प्रिपेयर्ड वेल एंड दिस प्रोग्राम विल बी वेरी सक्सेसफुल. In coming days, we will organize such other programs. With these words, I once again thank each and everyone. Thank you.
Sir, thank you very much. अभी हम जो सुन रहे थे मुझे लगा कि शायद सर पॉलिटिकल साइंस का प्रोफेसर है। सर थैंक यू, यू हैव वेरी कीन इंटरेस्ट एंड यू हैव ऑल्सो वेरी डीप नॉलेज अबाउट द प्रोसीडिंग्स एंड द प्रोसेस ऑफ द एक्टिविटीज ऑफ द पार्लियामेंट्री प्रोसीडिंग्स। सर यू हैव एलिटेड अस विथ योर deep knowledge and experience, and you are also very highly connected to the big political leaders of this country. That is another thing by which we can get knowledge, which you have already shared with the students, how you are connected to the speaker of the Lok Sabha and some other dignitaries. So thank you very much for your valuable suggestions and knowledge you have shared with us. मुझे तो लग रहा था जैसे मैं कोई पोलिटिकल साइंस का क्लास अटेंड कर रहा हूँ। तो आई रियली सर इट वॉज वेरी इंटरेस्टिंग एंड आई एम वेरी मच थैंकफुल टू यू फॉर योर वैल्यूएबल कंट्रीब्यूशन इन दिस प्रोग्राम। थैंक यू, थैंक यू वेरी मच सर।
Honorable members, a very good evening to all of you. I welcome you all to today's parliament session, and I hope this session will be fruitful. We begin today's session with oath or affirmation of our newly elected members. Secretary General, please.
Srimati Adarsha Das, who stands elected from Bankura constituency of West Bengal state, will now take an oath or affirmation. Srimati Adarsha Das, please. Srimati Adarsha Das, do you want to take an oath or affirmation?
Oath, please.
In which language would you like to take the oath?
In Bengali, please. আমি আদর্শ দাস সহশ্রদ্ধ চিত্তে শপথ করিতেছি যে আমি মন্ত্রী পদের কর্তব্য বিশ্বস্ততার সহিত পালন করিব। আমি পশ্চিমবঙ্গের প্রতি অকৃত্রিম বিশ্বাস ও অনুগত্য পোষণ করিব। আমি সংবিধানের রক্ষণ সমর্থন ও নিরাপত্তা বিধান করিব এবং আমি ভীতি বা অনুগ্রহ অনুরাগ বা বিরাগের বশবর্তী না হইয়া সকলের প্রতি আইন অনুযায়ী যথাবিহিত আচরণ করিব।
Now, Srimati Nikita Panda, who stands elected from Baripada constituency of Odisha state, will now take an oath or affirmation. Srimati Nikita Panda, please. Srimati Nikita Panda, do you want to take an oath or affirmation?
Oath, please.
In which language would you like to take the oath?
In Odia. निकिता पंडा ईश्वरों नाम से शपथ ग्रहण करुअछि जे आईन अनुजाई संविधान प्रति विश्वस्त और अनुगत रही एवं मते जेउ कार्यभार प्रदान करा जिबो ताकु सुचारू रूपे ग्रहण करिबी।
honorable members, as we meet today, it is my sad duty to inform the House of the demise of our former colleague, Shri Mulayam Singh Yadav. Shri Mulayam Singh Yadav was an Indian politician, a socialist figure, and the founder of Samajwadi Party. He served three non-consecutive terms as the Chief Minister of Uttar Pradesh and also as the Minister of Defence, Government of India. A long-time parliamentarian, he was the Member of Parliament representing the Mainpuri constituency in the Lok Sabha and earlier had also represented the Azamgarh, Sambhal and Kannauj constituencies. He passed away at Gurugram, Haryana on 10th October 2022 at the age of 82. I request Honorable Prime Minister to share a few words.
Honorable Speaker, Madam, I rise to pay my tributes to Shri Mulayam Singh Yadav, whose death has been deeply mourned by all. An able parliamentarian and a great orator, his loss would never be felt by anyone far and near. He was with us to the very last moment. I would like to extend my deep condolences to his family.
Honorable Leader of Opposition, would you like to share your thoughts?
Honorable Speaker, Madam, I associate myself with the tributes paid by you and the Leader of the House. I had the privilege to work with Shri Mulayam Singh Yadav. He was a person who, because of his lovable nature, never annoyed anyone, and he was always with a smiling face and an open heart. I would like to associate myself and my party in sending condolences to the bereaved family.
The House may now stand in silence for a while to express our deep sorrow. Secretary General, may please convey the message of condolence to the bereaved family.
Yes, Madam.
Now, Honorable Prime Minister, to introduce the new ministers.
Honorable Speaker, Madam, I have great pleasure in introducing to you and through you to the House, my colleagues, the new ministers. Number one, Shriman Sapan Kumar, Honorable Minister of Sports. Number two, Shriman Ankit Kumar, Honorable Minister of Industries and Commerce. Number three, Shriman Shubham Pramanik, Honorable Minister of Labour.
Thank you, and it is now time for the question hour. To begin with, I request Srimati Nisha Kumari to inaugurate the question hour.
माननीय अध्यक्ष महोदया, जैसा कि सदन के सभी माननीय सदस्य जानते ही है कि परमाणु ऊर्जा बिजली का चौथा सबसे बड़ा क्षेत्र है, लेकिन हमारी सरकार इन संसाधनों को विकसित करने में काफी असक्षम और सुस्त लगी है। राष्ट्रहित की बात करने वाली सरकार से मैं यह पूछना चाहती हूँ कि इन संसाधनों को विकसित कर राष्ट्र के निर्माण का कार्य करेंगे या फिर सिर्फ पूंजीपतियों के लोन ही माफ करते रहेंगे। Anyways, coming back to the questions. A, whether the domestic investment is not sufficient for producing the atomic energy in the country? If so, the details including and the reasons thereon. B, whether the government has any plan for action of producing the atomic energy in one of the most potential states of Maharashtra? If so, the district-wise details thereon. C, whether any plan has been prepared to promote the foreign direct investment, FDI, in the atomic energy sector? If so, the details thereof.
Thank you. Honorable Prime Minister is requested to reply.
थैंक यू स्पीकर मैडम. हिंदी साहित्य में एक कहावत है, नीम हकीम खतरे जान. इसका अर्थ यह है कि अल्प ज्ञान अज्ञान से अधिक हानिकारक है.
सिर्फ काव्य ही करते रहिए आप, और क्या आता है आपको?
सुनिए, धैर्य रखिए, सुन लीजिए. पहले हमने जान लिया कि परमाणु ऊर्जा बिजली का चौथा सबसे बड़ा स्रोत है. हमने ये भी जान लिया कि भारत में बिजली के उत्पादन में उतार चढ़ाव आए हैं, पर अगर थोड़ा सा कष्ट हम और करके ये भी पता लगाते कि वर्तमान सरकार ने मात्र 7 साल में, जी हाँ मात्र 7 साल में, भारत को विश्व परमाणु ऊर्जा सक्षमता श्रेणी में 18वें स्थान से 13वें स्थान पर ला खड़ा कर दिया, तो आज शायद हमें ये सवाल सरकार को ना करना पड़ता. तो इससे पता चलता है कि सुस्त और असक्षम असल में कौन है. वेल, आंसरिंग पार्ट ए, देयर आर प्रेजेंटली 22 रिएक्टर्स विद ए कैपेसिटी ऑफ 6780 मेगावाट्स इन ऑपरेशन एंड 11 रिएक्टर्स विद ए टोटल कैपेसिटी ऑफ 8700 मेगावाट्स अंडर कमिश्निंग एट वेरियस स्टेजेस इंक्लूडिंग द KAPP-3. इन एडिशन the government has accorded administrative approval and financial sanction for 10 reactors with an aggregate capacity of 7000 megawatts. The capital investment for the nuclear power projects is being funded with a debt to equity ratio of 70:30. And this equity part is funded from internal sources of NPCIL and government budgetary support. Government of India has amended the Atomic Energy Act 1962 in 2015 to enable joint ventures of public sector enterprises to set up nuclear power projects to boost domestic investment. As stated above, there is a consistent increase in number of operating reactors based on successful adoption of proper methodologies. Answering part C, the state of Maharashtra has always been on our priority list in terms of atomic and nuclear strength, and that is why the government has accorded in principle approval for setting up 6 nuclear power reactors of 1650 megawatts capacity each in cooperation with France at Jaitapur site in Ratnagiri district of Maharashtra. Answering part E, I think that the opposition doesn't keep a record of what actually happens in the country rather than crying on issues that barely exist. Still I am answering your question. The present policy, please note that the present policy on FDI puts atomic energy in the list of prohibited sectors. However, there is no restriction, I repeat, no restriction on foreign direct investment in the nuclear industry for manufacturing of equipment and providing other supplies for nuclear power plants and related other facilities. I hope I have answered your questions. Thank you.
Thank you. I now request Srimati Tamanna Acharya to ask her question.
Dhanyavaad. Honorable Speaker, Madam, I would like to request Minister of Health and Family Welfare to answer my following questions. Mantri ji, thora dhyan se suniyega. A. Where the Directorate of Health Services, DHS, has conducted inspection of private hospitals in Delhi to ascertain the admission of poor patients under EWS provisions. B. If so, the details thereof. And if not, the steps taken to ensure the adherence of norms by the private hospital in this regard. C. Whether hospitals have been ordered to reserve the stipulated quota for EWS patients for the special categories of treatments like liver, spinal injuries, and such others, and if so, the details thereof. D. The steps taken by the government to curb fronted conversion of free beds of EWS patient to paid category. And E. Whether the government is having any proposal to impose monetary penalty for not adhering to the guidelines prescribed in this regard, and if so, the details thereof. Care. सरकार कहें जिस हमर अस्पताल में सभी के लिए सब व्यवस्था है, हमर सरकार से प्रश्न है गरीब लोगन के लिए की है.
Honorable Minister of Health and Social Welfare is requested to reply.
आदरणीय अध्यक्ष महोदया, मैं ये आशा करती हूँ कि हमारा विपक्ष इस बात को अपने दिमाग में डाल ले कि हमारी सरकार स्वास्थ्य जैसी नाजुक विषय को इतने हल्के में नहीं लेती है। मैं चाहूँगी कि विपक्ष के इस नेता अपने प्रश्नों को पूछने से पहले थोड़ा अच्छे से जांच पड़ताल कर ले। एनीवेज, कमिंग बैक टू द क्वेश्चंस आस्क्ड, आंसरिंग बिट ए टू ई, हेल्थ इज अ स्टेट सब्जेक्ट, इट इज फॉर द रिप्रेजेंटेटिव स्टेट और यूनियन टेरिटरी गवर्नमेंट टू एंश्योर दैट प्राइवेट हॉस्पिटल्स प्रोवाइड फ्री ट्रीटमेंट टू द पुअर पेशेंट्स एज पर देयर नॉर्म्स इंक्लूडिंग मॉनिटरिंग देयर ऑफ and curb any kind of fraudulent practice by them and take punitive measures. As informed by the National Capital Territory of Delhi, GNCTD, inspection of private hospitals in Delhi has been carried out as per details which are annexed. As per the issues, the guidelines issued by the Government of National Capital Territory of Delhi, all private hospitals which were allotted land at concessional rates by land-owning agencies were directed to provide 10% inpatient department IPD and 25% total outpatient department OPD to eligible patients of economically weaker sections category. The identified private hospitals have been directed to reserve 10% of total bed capacity as well as 10% of the ICU bed capacity. However, beds are not reserved specialty-wise in identified private hospitals. Various steps have also been taken by the Government of National Capital Territory of Delhi to curb fraudulent conversions of free beds of EWS patients to paid category, such as point one, all the identified private hospitals have been directed to earmark the free beds and affix a board on towards the head end of each free bed, mentioning free bed. Point number two, real-time availability of free beds is available on the public portal. Point number three, senior nursing officers have been posted as liaison officers in private hospitals to facilitate the patients and monitor free beds. And D, regular inspections by the monitoring committee constituted by the Government of National Capital Territory of Delhi. The Government of National Capital Territory of Delhi have any proposal to impose penalty for non-adherence to the guidelines prescribed in this regard. However, the implementation of the guidelines is monitored on a day-to-day basis by the government. Mahadaya, aap apni sehat ka dhyan rakhein. देश के तमाम लोगों के सेहत का ध्यान रखने के लिए हम हैं।
हमें अपने स्वास्थ्य से ज्यादा देश का चिंता है, हम आपकी तरह नहीं हैं। हमें अपने स्वास्थ्य से ज्यादा देश की चिंता है।
I now request श्रीमती शिपोर्णा पात्र to ask her query.
माननीय अध्यक्ष महोदय, मैं आपके माध्यम से सरकार से ये पूछना चाहती हूँ कि वैश्विक महामारी के दौरान सरकार ने रातों रात जो विद्यालय बंद करवा दिए हैं, उस कारण हुए शैक्षिक नुकसान के संबंध में, विशेषकर दादरा और नगर हवेली और लक्षद्वीप के संबंध में, सरकार ने ऐसे कौन कौन से ठोस कदम उठाए हैं? अखंड भारत की बात करने वाले सरकार पहले वर्तमान भारत के महत्वपूर्ण हिस्सों का तो ध्यान कर ले। आंध्र प्रदेश पुनर्गठन अधिनियम 2014 के अंतर्गत सरकार ने आंध्र प्रदेश में राष्ट्रीय महत्व के शैक्षिक संस्थानों की स्थापना हेतु क्या क्या कदम उठाए हैं? वैसे तो इस सरकार से शिक्षा के बारे में पूछना अदरक का स्वाद पूछने जैसा होगा, पर यदि सरकार इन प्रश्नों का जवाब सत्यनिष्ठा के साथ दे दे और सिर्फ जवाब ही नहीं उनको जमीनी स्तर पर लागू भी करे तो बड़ी मेहरबानी होगी।
माननीय शिक्षा मंत्री से अनुरोध है कि उत्तर दें।
धन्यवाद, धन्यवाद महोदया. एक शेर है कि गिरते हैं सहसवार ही मैदाने जंग में, वो तिफल क्या गिरे जो घुटने के बल चले. माननीय अध्यक्ष महोदया, मैं आपके माध्यम से सदन में पूछे गए सवालों का जवाब देना चाहूँगा, लेकिन उससे पहले मैं इनके आरोपों का खंडन करना चाहता हूँ. ये वो लोग जो सालों साल दशकों तक सत्ता की मलाई चाटते, जो लुटियंस जोन में बैठे देश को चला रहे थे, वो लोग पूछ रहे हैं वर्तमान सरकार से शिक्षा की बात करना, वो लोग पूछ रहे हैं. मैं उनका जवाब देना चाहूँगा कि आप जो प्रश्न पूछे कि अखंड भारत की बात करने वाली सरकार अभी क्या कर रही है. माननीय अध्यक्ष महोदया, हमारे यशस्वी प्रधानमंत्री जी के नेतृत्व में जब संपूर्ण विश्व कोविड-19 से जूझ रहा था, संपूर्ण विश्व में जो मृत्यु दर थी वो बढ़ चुकी थी, यशस्वी प्रधानमंत्री जी की ये दूरदर्शिता थी कि इन्होंने बहुत ही जल्दबाजी में कदम उठाया, एहतियात बरता और तमाम स्कूल और कॉलेजेस को बंद किया. उसके बाद बच्चों की पढ़ाई रुक रही थी. आपको इस बात का चिंता तो हो रहा है, लेकिन आप जरा ध्यान लगाइए, अपने अक्ल को ध्यान में रखकर बताइए कि क्या इस देश को चलाने वाली सरकार जिस भवन में चलती है, क्या वह भवन का कार्य स्थगित नहीं हुआ था? जब हम यहाँ पर अपना काम नहीं कर पा रहे हैं, तो जाहिर सी बात है हम यह कहते हैं कि बच्चों की शिक्षा में थोड़ी सी त्रुटि हुई, उनकी शिक्षा में थोड़ी सी कमी आई, लेकिन ये समस्या थी जो विपक्ष हमेशा देखता है. विपक्ष को तो समस्या पर ही ध्यान रहता है, लेकिन यशस्वी प्रधानमंत्री हमारे जो बस देश को अपना देश के लिए तत्पर रहते हैं, हमारी पार्टी के जितने भी कार्यकर्ता हैं सब के लिए पहले देश आता है उसके बाद अपना वैल्यू करते हैं, उन लोगों ने अपने मेहनत से रेडियो पर डिजिटल सुविधा दिलवाई, सामुदायिक रेडियो के माध्यम से हमारे समाज में कुछ ऐसे भी बच्चे हैं जिनके पास अभी भी इंटरनेट की सुविधा नहीं है. ये क्यों नहीं है, इस बात पर तो विपक्ष कुछ नहीं बोलेंगे, चुप्पी साध लेंगे. आज संपूर्ण विश्व मान रहा है कि 2014 के बाद भारत में डिजिटल क्रांति आई, इंटरनेट के जगत में भारत अपना कीर्तिमान स्थापित कर रहा है, भारत के लोग अपना संसाधन तक पहुंच पा रहे हैं. तो जिन लोगों के पास इंटरनेट की सुविधाएं हैं, उन लोगों को ई लर्निंग की व्यवस्था की गई. हमारे यशस्वी प्रधानमंत्री जी ने स्टेट के मिनिस्टरों के साथ, तमाम शिक्षाविदों के साथ मीटिंग किया और निर्णय लिया कि किस तरीके से जो बच्चे पढ़ाई नहीं कर रहे हैं, घर पे बैठे हुए हैं, उन लोगों की पढ़ाई भी बाधित ना हो और वो कोरोना के संक्रमण से संक्रमित भी ना हो. तो उन लोगों के लिए NCERT ने अपना जो पाठ्यक्रम था उसका वैकल्पिक पाठ्यक्रम बनाया, उसको रिवाइज किया, और ऐसे लोग जो इन सुविधाओं को प्राप्त नहीं कर पाते थे उनके लिए भारत सरकार ने ब्रिज कोर्स की स्थापना की. उसके माध्यम से PM हमारे प्रधानमंत्री ने ई विद्या लाया, उसके माध्यम से स्वयं प्रभा चैनल लाया, उसके माध्यम से एक एक बच्चे तक को शिक्षा पहुंचे, इसकी गारंटी देते हैं. और आप शिक्षा का 3 सिद्धांत है, पहुंच, समता और गुणवत्ता. जिस तरीके से हम देश पे उंगली उठाने वाले तत्वों को बर्दाश्त नहीं कर सकते, उसी तरह इस देश के जो बच्चे हैं, जो देश के कर्णधार हैं, उनके साथ भी हम कोई समझौता नहीं कर सकते. हम समता, गुणवत्ता और शिक्षा पर खास ध्यान रखते हैं. रही बात आंध्र प्रदेश पुनर्गठन के बारे में, ये कैसा कैसा आरोप है महोदया. तभी तो किसी ने कहा है कि समझने ही नहीं देती सियासत हमको सच्चाई, समझने ही नहीं देती सियासत हमको सच्चाई, कभी चेहरा नहीं मिलता, कभी दर्पण नहीं मिलता. लेकिन महोदया आप शांत रहिए, घबराइए मत. महोदया, मैं आपके माध्यम से बताना चाहूंगा कि हमारे प्रधानमंत्री जी के नेतृत्व में चेहरा भी मिलता है और दर्पण भी मिलता है. आंध्र प्रदेश में औद्योगिक शिक्षा के लिए IIT जैसे संस्थान को स्थापित किया गया, NIT जैसे संस्थान को स्थापित किया गया,
और आपको मालूम है कि जब कोई नया संस्थान खुलता है तो परमानेंट जो उसकी कैंपस होती है उसको में वक्त लगता है। तो जब पहली बार हमें जनता ने चुनकर यहाँ भेजा था जनता की सेवा करने के लिए, तो हमने वहाँ पर संस्थान की स्थापना की थी। और जब हम दूसरी बार यहाँ पे आए तो आज IIT और NIT में बच्चे अपने अस्थाई जमीन पर रहते हैं, हॉस्टल की संपूर्ण सुविधा है वहाँ पर। और बात अदरक की हो रही थी तो मैं बता दूँ, ये लोग जो लुटियंस जोन में बैठे वो लोग क्या जाने, हम लोग तो किसान परिवार से आते हैं, हम लोग आंदोलन किए, हम लोग का अच्छा खासा सफर रहा है सत्ता तक पहुंचने पर। जब जनता ने इनको नकार दिया तो इन लोगों को अभी भी सच्चाई नहीं मालूम है, इन लोगों तो बस अदरक ही मालूम है। तो मैं आपको बताना चाहता हूँ, हमारे यशस्वी प्रधानमंत्री जी के नेतृत्व में हम लोगों ने जो किसानी करना चाहते हैं, जो खेती करना चाहते हैं और जो बच्चे पढ़ना चाहते हैं उनके लिए आंध्र प्रदेश में कृषि विश्वविद्यालय की भी स्थापना किया, भारतीय विज्ञान और शिक्षा अनुसंधान संस्थान भी खोला, और तमाम संस्थान के जो केंद्रीय महत्व रखते हैं वैसा ऐसा खोला गया है। तो हम ये अपील करते हैं विपक्ष से कि सदन जो बहुत अच्छा से चल रहा है, हमें बहुत जनता ने जो प्यार दिया है वो हमें काम करने के लिए दिया है। आप लोग भी यहाँ चुन कर आए हैं, आप लोग भी अपने अपने संसदीय क्षेत्र में काम कीजिए। यहाँ पर बहस करके ऐसे ऐसे क्वेश्चन उठा लेते हैं जिसका कोई हाथ प्यार ही नहीं रहता है, वो सब पूछ के सदन का वक्त बर्बाद होता है। आप उसको थोड़ा संभालिए और काम कीजिए, काम की मुद्दे पर बात कीजिए। धन्यवाद अध्यक्ष महोदया।
घुटने के बल ही सही शिक्षा मंत्री, हमने देश चलाया है 70 साल और आप किसानों के बैकग्राउंड से आते हो और यहाँ पे हमारे देश में किसान ही धरने पे बैठ रहे हैं, उसको देखा है आपने? देखेंगे कैसे, आप तो गलती छुपाने में लगे हैं।
सब देखा है हमने और उसके अनुसार काम भी चल रहा है। आप की बौखलाहट को हम समझ सकते हैं।
शिक्षा की बात आप ना करें, आपकी पार्टी ना करे तो ही अच्छा है।
देख के तो आंख बंद करना कोई आपसे सीखे।
सदन की गरिमा बौखलाहट
हम समझ सकते हैं। आप बहुत दिन के बाद विपक्ष में बैठे हैं,
काम पे ध्यान दीजिए, काम पे ध्यान दीजिए, टिप्पणियों पे नहीं।
यहाँ पे क्या आप शेर और शायरी करने आए हैं?
शेर और शायरी करने नहीं, वो आप नहीं समझ, आपको शेर और शायरी लगता है लेकिन वो बात जनता की आवाज थी। जन कवि नागार्जुन हुए है, दिनकर जी हुए है, उन लोगों ने जनता की बात रखी। वही होता है ना कि जब हम जिसको चुनते हैं वो अपनी बात नहीं कहते हैं तो कवि को वो काम करना पड़ता है, लेकिन हम दोनों बात समझते हैं। आप लोग भी समझिए और अध्यक्ष महोदय की बात मानिए।
अगले इलेक्शन तक आपको सब समझ में आ जाएगा।
सदन जनता की भावना बनाए रखें, प्लीज मेंटेन द डेकोरम ऑफ द हाउस। आई नाउ रिक्वेस्ट श्रीमान कृष्ण मिश्रा टू आस्क हिज क्वेश्चन।
Honorable Speaker Madam, I would like to request the Minister of Home Affairs to answer the following questions. The details of the data from Socio-Economic Caste Census SECC of 2011. वैसे तो ऐसे सवालात एक ऐसी सरकार से करना जो कभी दलितों की कभी अल्पसंख्यकों की रही ही नहीं है, भैंस के आगे बीन बजाने जैसा है। फिर भी whether the government has any proposal for on using the said data in the coming times, especially in the light of possibility of conducting a caste census. If so, the details thereof. Part C, whether the government is of the opinion that a caste census will help in highlighting the contemporary realities pertaining to castes in the country. If so, the details thereof. Please, madam.
Honorable Home Minister is requested to reply.
माननीय अध्यक्ष महोदय, मैं नेताजी एवं विपक्ष के बाकी साथियों को ये बताना चाहूंगी कि आप जिस सरकार को अल्पसंख्यकों की मानते ही नहीं, उसी सरकार ने, हाँ जी मैं दोहराना चाहूंगी, उसी सरकार ने हमारे माननीय प्रधानमंत्री जी के नेतृत्व में अल्पसंख्यकों के लिए जबरदस्त काम किया है। यदि मैं उन सब बातों को विस्तार रूप से बताने जाऊं तो शायद समय सीमा को ही पार कर जाएगा।
समय सीमा का तो पता नहीं, पर आपके सरकार की झूठ बोलने और जनता को गुमराह करने की सीमा को जरूर पार करें।
अरे हमें बोलने तो दीजिए, आइए आइए, आप ही सत्ता संभालिए, आइए।
छोड़ दीजिए।
प्लीज मेंटेन द डेकोरम ऑफ द हाउस।
धन्यवाद महोदय, आशा है कि अब विपक्ष के सारे नेता उनसे पूछे गए प्रश्नों के सवाल के उत्तर अच्छे से सुनेंगे। आपके पहले तीन प्रश्नों के उत्तर देते हुए हम ये कहना चाहेंगे कि जातिगत आंकड़ों को छोड़कर सामाजिक, आर्थिक और जातीय जनगणना के आंकड़ों को अंतिम रूप दिया गया है और ग्रामीण विकास मंत्रालय और आवास और शहरी मामलों के मंत्रालय द्वारा प्रकाशित किया गया है। SECC रिपोर्ट पोर्टल secc.gov.in पर उपलब्ध है, कृपया इसे लिख लीजिए। जैसा कि सामाजिक न्याय और अधिकारिता मंत्रालय द्वारा सूचित किया गया है, इस स्तर पर जाति डेटा को फिर से तैयार करने का कोई प्रस्ताव नहीं है। आपके आखिरी दो प्रश्नों के उत्तर ध्यान से सुनिएगा माननीय। संविधान अनुसूचित जाति आदेश 1950 और संविधान अनुसूचित जनजाति आदेश 1950 के अनुसार अनुसूचित जाति एवं अनुसूचित जनजाति के रूप में विशेष रूप से अधिसूचित जातियों और जनजातियों को जनगणना में गिना जाता है। भारत सरकार ने आजादी के बाद से जनगणना में SC और ST के अलावा अन्य जातिवाद जनसंख्या की गणना नहीं की है।
क्या ही किया है इस सरकार ने, कुछ नहीं किया है, कामचोर सरकार है।
क्या बात करते हैं अग्रेसिव होने की, जान दे देंगे ST/ST के लिए। धन्यवाद।
I now request Srimati Priya Mandal to ask her query.
Honorable Speaker, our government always claims to be very transparent to Indian public, but we don't think so that this is the case, because if this was the case, then we would not have to ask question over here. Well, being a transparent government, will the Ministry of Space be pleased to state that whether the government proposed to transfer 10 in-orbit communication satellites to New Space Indian Limited, which is the commercial arm of Indian Space Research Organization, popularly known as ISRO. B. If so, the details thereof and the details therefore. Whether C. Whether the government has taken any step for increasing Indian's share in global space market. D. If so, the detail thereof.
Thank you. Honorable Prime Minister, please.
Thank you, Speaker Madam. Answering part A and B, 10 in-orbit operational communication satellites that are GSAT-8, GSAT-10 and so on have been transferred from Government of India to measures New Space India Limited, a CPSC under Department of Space, at a written down value of 4,697.60 crores against issue of equity to Government of India with 1st April 2021 as the effective date of transfer. The board of NSIL is authorized to price the transponder capacity as per the global trends. The transfer of operational satellites is part of the space sector reforms aimed at strengthening the role of NSIL in order to enhance the nation's share in global space economy. यहाँ पे transparency की बात की गई है, वो क्या है? Transparency को देखने के लिए, transparency असल में होती क्या चीज है, इसको जानना जरूरी है। पर ये transparency के बारे में कैसे जानेंगे जब 70 साल के उनके सत्ता में उनके बाएं हाथ को नहीं पता चला कि उनका दायां हाथ क्या कर रहा है। Well, answering part C and D, yes, why not? Why not? Government has taken several steps to increase India's share in global space market through the reforms undertaken in 2020, which seek to augment the space sector in the country with greater participation of non-governmental entities. The Indian National Space Promotion and Authorization Center, which is also known as InSpace, has been created as a single window agency to promote, handhold,
and authorize the activities of NGEs in the sector, thus providing them with a level playing field. With the functioning of InSpace, the progressively evolving regulatory environment, a greater private sector participation in end-to-end space activities is expected, which may result in increased share of India in the global space economy. Thank you.
Thank you. I request Srimati Paramita Khatua to ask her query.
Honorable Speaker, Madam, I would like to request Minister of Defense to answer my questions. जैसे कि आपके सरकार ने कहा है कि no one can take an inch of our land. So, Madam, whether the government has taken note of the Chinese soldiers' incursions and transgressions into the border areas of our country, including the Ladakh region of Jammu and Kashmir? B. Whether the matter of such incursions and transgressions has been discussed with the Chinese president during his visit to India in the recent past? C. If so, then the details thereof. And if not, the reasons therefore and the other corrective steps taken and being taken by the government in this regard.
Honorable Minister of Defense, please.
Honorable Speaker, Madam, भारत अपने इतिहास में हमेशा से एक शांतिप्रिय देश रहा है. उसने हमेशा समझौते का साथ दिया है. लेकिन अगर कल को कोई भारत की ओर गंदी नजरों से देखता है और अगर उसे उसकी अखंडता, अक्षुण्णता और एवं एकता को खतरा बनेगा तो उसे करारा जवाब दिया जाएगा. Answering bit A of your question, there is no commonly delineated line of actual control in the border areas between India and China. And there are areas along LAC where both sides have differing perceptions of the LAC. Due to both sides undertaking their respective perceptions of the LAC, transgressions do occur. However, government is taking enough measures to ensure that defense forces are in a state of readiness to meet the operational and security challenges. साथ ही मैं इस सदन को यह आश्वासन देती हूँ कि हमारी सेना की तरफ से कोई भूल चूक की गुंजाइश नहीं रहेगी. During the recent visit of Chinese President to India, views were exchanged on outstanding issues, including on the boundary question. Issues discussed also included efforts to arrive at a mutually agreed framework for fair, reasonable, and mutually acceptable settlement based on the political parameters and guiding principles agreed by the both sides in 2005 to ensure peace and tranquility in the border areas and additional confidence building measures. अंततः मैं यह कहना चाहूंगी कि विपक्षी दल को शायद ये भरोसा ना हो, लेकिन हमें अपनी सेना की क्षमता और साहस पर पूर्ण विश्वास है. हमारी सरकार उनके साथ हर एक मोड़ पर खड़ी है और मैं ये एक बार नहीं हजार बार दोहराऊंगी कि कोई आज भी हमारी सीमा की एक इंच जमीन भी हमसे छीन नहीं सकता है.
महोदया, आपके सरकार के नेतृत्व में ही घुसपैठ हो रही है. और खैर छोड़िए घुसपैठ की बात, उधर जो हमारे इंडिया का जो लैंड चाइना ने लेके बैठी है उस पे थोड़ा ध्यान दीजिए प्लीज.
इसका कारण आपकी सरकार के दौरान लिए गए कमजोर निर्णय है जिसे हम सुधारने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं. तो बेहतर यही होगा कि आप अपनी कुर्सी संभालें और सीमा की सुरक्षा की चिंता हम पर छोड़ दें.
अगर आपकी सरकार इतना ही काम कर रही है तो पुलवामा अटैक में इतने सारे जवानों की जान क्यों गई?
तो आपको ये नहीं पता कि पुलवामा अटैक के बाद हमने पाकिस्तान में क्या किया था?
किए गए इतने खराब क्वालिटी के खाने के बारे में आप क्या कहना चाहोगे जिसके बारे में वो खुद आवाज उठा रहे हैं?
आपने 70 साल में इतना दिया ही है जो हम इतना ही दे पा रहे हैं.
70 साल की बात छोड़िए, आपने 8 साल में क्या कर लिया?
8 साल में जितना
जीएसटी लगाया.
हाँ लगाया.
बोलने दीजिए.
आप अपनी सत्ता, आप अपनी जो कुर्सी है उसे संभालिए और चिंता ये सारे हम पे छोड़ दीजिए. वो तो हम संभाल रहे हैं.
आप तो हमेशा आश्वासन ही देते रहते हैं जैसे कि आपने अभी कहा.
आप पे छोड़ रखा तभी ना इतनी गुस्सेगियां हो रही हैं, तभी ना हमें आना पड़ रहा है सवाल पूछने.
अनुरोध है कि सब सदन का गरिमा बनाए, सदन की गरिमा बनाए रखें. I now request Shriman Aryan Kumar to ask his question.
Honorable Speaker, Madam, with your permission, I would like to ask my questions to the Finance Minister. Will the Minister of Finance be pleased to state the dates on which Pradhan Mantri Suraksha Bima Yojana and Pradhan Mantri Jeevan Jyoti Bima Yojana were launched by the government? Also, I would like to ask our Finance Minister that why she has never ever been vocal about the process of selection of beneficiaries under the said schemes. Speaker Madam, why Finance Minister has never been vocal and accountable for any real issues, be it depreciating Indian rupee, be it inflation, or be it falling GDP?
Honorable Minister of Finance is requested to reply.
Honorable Speaker, Madam, first of all, I would like to state from my party and the government, I assure every members in this house that debates like such, we have always keen to participate because we strongly believe in parliamentary democracy unlike the opposition. आज पैंडेमिक हो उसके बाद भी रशिया यूक्रेन वॉर हो उसके बाद भी भारत की इकोनॉमी फास्टेस्ट ग्रोइंग इकोनॉमी है. Also, madam, it is extremely sad that some people in the parliament are not at all happy, in fact jealous of country's growing economy rather of being proud of India's growth. Some people in the parliament take it as a joke. Anyway, starting off with the dates of the said scheme, Pradhan Mantri Jeevan Jyoti Yojana and Pradhan Mantri Suraksha Bima Yojana were launched by the Honorable Prime Minister on Pan India basis on 9th of May 2015. Speaking of the process of selection, Pradhan Mantri Suraksha Bima Yojana is a one-year personal bank accident insurance scheme renewable from year to year and is available on Pan India basis to bank or post office account holders in the age of 80 to 70 years who give their consent to join and enable auto debit. Now, speaking of the state-wise and district-wide beneficiaries, state-wise details of beneficiaries in terms of number and amount of claims paid under Pradhan Mantri Suraksha Bima Yojana since 2017 are at Annexure 1 and Annexure 2 respectively. I hope I answered your questions. Thank you.
भारत में ऐसे बहुत सारे लोग हैं जिनको दो वक्त की रोटी भी नहीं मिलती. भारत की हंगर इंडेक्स के बारे में आप क्या कहना चाहेंगे?
अध्यक्ष महोदया, शायद इनको मालूम नहीं कि दो वक्त की रोटी क्यों नहीं मिलती. 70 सालों में इन्होंने क्या किया है?
इसका जवाब तो नहीं दे रहे हैं.
हम आपकी बातों का कड़ी निंदा करते हैं.
आप जवाब नहीं दे सकते इसीलिए आप बोलने से मना कर रहे हैं.
मना नहीं कर रहा हूँ. आपका प्रश्न विषय से विषयांतर हो रहा है. आप सदन की गरिमा को डिस्टर्ब कर रहे हैं.
आपको शायद पता नहीं है हंगर इंडेक्स भी देश के फाइनेंस में ही आता है. अगर लोगों को खाने नहीं मिल रहा.
आप पता कीजिए माननीय सदस्यगण, आप क्रोनोलॉजी समझिए. ये हंगर इंडेक्स कहां से ये होता है, कहां से इसका आंकड़ा आता है, पता कीजिए.
प्लीज मेंटेन द डेकोरम ऑफ द हाउस. नेक्स्ट अप वी हैव मोहम्मद सलमान अंसारी. प्लीज.
Honorable Speaker, Madam, I would like to request the Honorable Prime Minister to answer my following questions regarding Department of Personnel and Training. Will the Prime Minister be pleased to state whether the government has introduced reservation for economically weaker section for direct recruitment in civil postal services in the government since 1st of February 2019? And if so, the details thereof. Whether residential plots situated adjacent to or within the agricultural land shall be considered as part of the agriculture land, and if so, whether the government is aware that in several states, including Kerala, the residential plots are part of agricultural plots and no clear distinction between agricultural plot and residential plot has been made. Looks like aajkal ki sarkar neend mein hi niyam bana rahi hai. Mohde, aap sirf apne daadi ke style pe nahi, thode desh pe bhi dhyan dijiye. If so, whether the government is considering the issue a classification on the aforesaid criteria, as many applicants are not able to get EWS certificates issued as the results thereof, and if so, the details thereof, and if not, the reasons therefor. Thank you.
Honorable Prime Minister, please.
Thank you, madam. Answering part A, the issue of EWS had been kept on hold for a very long time by the previous government. Nobody knows why. But I feel very proud to state that our government has resolved this issue in the quickest time possible. So please note, in pursuance of Article 16.6 of the Constitution, and in order to enable the EWS who are not covered under the existing scheme of reservations for the scheduled castes and the scheduled tribes and the socially and educationally backward classes to receive the benefit of reservation in civil posts and services in the Government of India, Department of Personnel and Training, White Office Memorandum dated 19-1-2019, has notified that 10%, yes, 10% reservation would be provided for EWS in central government posts and services and would be effective in respect of all direct recruitment vacancies to be notified on or before 1st of February 2023. Answering part C, as this issue falls in the domain of the concerned state governments, it is considered in terms of the relevant state government guidelines. Answering part D, the state government of Kerala has already been intimated regarding this issue and they will be submitting a preliminary report next month. Answering part E and F, as per the directions of the Supreme Court in Civil Litigation Petition number 961 of 2021, Neil Aurelio Nunes versus Union of India, a committee was constituted by the government under the chairmanship of Sri Ajay Bhushan Pandey, the former Finance Secretary, Government of India, on 30th November 2021, with certain terms of reference which have been communicated to the concerned stakeholders. The committee submitted its report to the government on 30th December 2021, which has immediately been submitted before the Supreme Court. और जहाँ तक बात है दाढ़ी की, अगर दाढ़ी रखने से देश में नकली नोटों का आदान प्रदान समाप्त हो जाता है, अगर दाढ़ी रखने से 370 जैसे विवादित आर्टिकल हट जाते हैं, अगर दाढ़ी रखने से देश के हर घर में शौचालय बन जाते हैं, तो मैं बोलता हूँ हर एक नेता को दाढ़ी रखना चाहिए, उस पर गर्व करना चाहिए। धन्यवाद।
धन्यवाद। I now request Srimati Anshu Chaudhary, please.
माननीय स्पीकर महोदया, मेरी खोज के अनुसार हमें नहीं लगता कि हमारी ये जो आदरणीय सरकार यहाँ पे जो बैठी हुई है, इन्होंने श्यामा प्रसाद मुखर्जी अर्बन अभियान से संबंधित कोई भी कार्य किया है। खैर, ऐसी सुस्त और कामचोर सरकार से और अपेक्षा भी क्या की जा सकती है? I would like to put forward my questions. A. Whether any representation has been received from the Ministry of Rural Development by the Department of Expenditure regarding release of funds for the Shyama Prasad Mukherjee Urban Mission? B. If so, the details thereof along with the actions taken thereon. C. Whether the Department of Economic Affairs has stated that 31st March 2022 is the sunset day for Shyama Prasad Mukherjee Urban Mission. D. If so, the reasons therefore. Evam, main apne mannya vitt mantri se ye bhi janna chahungi ki hamare adarniya sarkar ne Shyama Prasad Mukherjee Urban Abhiyan se sambandhit dhan jari kyun nahi kiya? कहीं ऐसा तो नहीं कि आप लोग धन जारी करने के डर से ही इस अभियान की समाप्ति की घोषणा कर दी?
I request Honorable Minister of Finance to answer this question.
Honorable Speaker Madam, सबसे पहली बात तो ये मैं बता दूं कि हमारी सरकार किसी से डरती नहीं है, क्योंकि
सिर्फ बोलने के लिए है,
क्योंकि हमारी सरकार ने जो पिछले 8 साल में कर दिखाया है वो आपकी सरकार 70 साल से करने में असमर्थ रही है।
ये सिर्फ बोलने के लिए है और कुछ नहीं, सिर्फ बोलने के लिए की डरती नहीं है।
Let me first speak, आप पहले सुन लीजिए। First of all, as far as representation from the ministry is concerned, yes ma'am, development of
expenditure had received communication from Ministry of Rural Development regarding release of funds under Shyama Prasad Mukherjee Urban Mission. As per figures submitted by MORD, I would like to state a total amount of rupees 288.89 crore till the end of financial year 2021-22 towards the total committed liabilities incurred on projects actually started on the ground under SPMRM. Thereafter, MORD in June 2022 again submitted revised liabilities figure under SPMRM and requested for its sanction and release. However, Department of Economic Affairs has stated that 31st March 2022 would be the sunset day for Shyama Prasad Urban Mission, that is only due to the absence of specific approval of competent authority. Aur ant mein main aapki jankari ke liye yeh bata dun ki Department of Expenditure ne rupaye jari karne ke liye ek antim swikriti pradan ki hai. 31 दिसंबर 2022 तक SPRM के तहत 807.397 करोड़ तथा 31 मार्च 2022 तक कुल प्रतिबंध देनदारियों के लिए. आई होप आई आंसर योर क्वेश्चंस. थैंक यू.
थैंक यू. अनुरोध करती हूँ अनुष्का विश्वास से, वो अपना प्रश्न पूछे.
माननीय अध्यक्ष महोदय, क्या सरकार यह बताने का कष्ट करेगी कि whether the government has taken cognizance of the report of National Family Health Survey 5, which indicates a 9% increase in case of anemia among children aged 6 months to 5 years. If so, the details thereof. Mera dusra prashna, Swastha aur Kalyan Mantralay, zara gaur farmaiyega. Why the number of such children is at a rattling level in states like Gujarat, Bihar, Jharkhand, Madhya Pradesh, Uttar Pradesh, Haryana, Maharashtra, Odisha, Andhra Pradesh, Delhi and West Bengal. Mantralay family welfare aur party welfare ke beech mein antar bhool gaya hai kya? Teesra, whether the government proposes to take any specific steps in this regard, and if so, the details thereof.
I request the Minister of Health and Social Welfare to answer this query.
Honorable Speaker Madam, party welfare kaise kiya jata hai, ye hamare vipaksh se behtar aur kaun hi jaan sakta hai. Anyways, let's get back to the question asked. For answers A to D, a statement is laid on the table of the House. For A and B, as per the fifth round of National Family Health Survey, NFHS, conducted by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare during the year 2021 and 22, the prevalence of anemia among children aged 6 months to 5 years is 67.1% as compared to 58.6% in National Family Health Survey 4 and National Family Health Survey 5. State or union territory wise prevalence of anemia among children aged 6 months to 5 years as per NFHS 4 and NFHS 5 is given at annexure, which is also laid on the table of the House. Answering C and D, the Government of India implements Anemia Mukt Bharat AMB strategy under Poshan Abhiyan with the target of reducing anemia in the six population groups. These six population groups include children aged 6 to 59 months, children aged 5 to 9 years, adolescent girls and boys aged 10 to 19 years, pregnant women, lactating women and women of reproductive age 15 to 49 in life cycle approach. Some of the major interventions by the MOHFW to address anemia under Anemia Mukt Bharat include: point 1, prophylactic iron and folic acid supplementation; second, deworming; third, testing of anemia using digital methods and point of care treatment; fourth, addressing non-nutritional causes in endemic pockets with special focus on malaria and fluorosis; fifth, engaging National Center of Excellence an advanced research on anemia control for capacity building of healthcare providers, and at last, monitoring progress in states, union territories, using Anemia Mukt Bharat dashboard. I hope I answered your question. Thank you.
क्या आप मुझे ये बोल सकते हैं कि कोविड 19 के समय जब देश को वैक्सीन का सबसे ज्यादा जरूरत था, तब उस वक्त आपने वैक्सीन को दूसरे देश में एक्सपोर्ट क्यों किया?
माननीय, मैं आपको ये बता दूं कि हमारा देश खुद से पहले दूसरों को रखता है। हम दूसरों
भले ही खुद मर क्यों ना जाए, ऐसे नेता की जरूरत नहीं है हमें।
दूसरों की नीति
ऐसे नेता की जरूरत नहीं है हमें।
और ये आप मत भूलिए,
बनाए रखे प्लीज मेंटेन द डेकोरम ऑफ द हाउस।
ये मत भूले कि हमने अपने देश की नीड भी पूरी की।
ना ऑक्सीजन अवेलेबल था, ना बेड्स अवेलेबल थे। ऐसे क्या आपने
आपको बस नेगेटिव भी दिखाई देगा, पॉजिटिव का भी थोड़ा ध्यान दें।
नाउ आई रिक्वेस्ट श्रीमती रेन शांडिल्य टू आस्क हर क्वेरी।
ऑनरेबल स्पीकर मैडम, इंडियाज नेशनैलिटी ऑन द यूक्रेन कॉन्फ्लिक्ट्स कुड हर्ट इन द लॉन्ग रन। इंडिया शार्पन स्टैंड ऑन यूक्रेन वॉर, बट बिजनेस एज यूजुअल विद रशिया। India is buying Ukrainian blood by purchasing Russian crude oil.
Members, please maintain the decorum of the house.
Will the Ministry of External Affairs be pleased to state A. the stand of Indian government on Russian-Ukraine war, B. the diplomatic efforts made by government to help India and diffuse war situation in Russia-Ukraine. See whether the Indian High Commission in Kyiv have restored full operation, and if so, the details thereof.
Honorable Minister of External Affairs is requested to reply.
Honorable Speaker Madam, we have been very open and honest about our interest. I have a country with per capita income $2,000. These are not the people who can afford high energy prices. So it's my obligation, yes, it's my obligation, my moral duty to actually get them the best deal that I can get from the world. Now answering you bit A and B. Since the beginning of conflict in Ukraine, India has consistently called for immediate cessation of hostilities and an end to the violence. India has called upon the both sides to return to the path of diplomacy and dialogue, and also expressed its support for all diplomatic efforts in order to end the conflict. Regarding the evacuation of Indian citizens, Prime Minister spoke to the presidents of Russia and Ukraine on multiple occasions. Prime Minister specifically took up the issue of safe evacuation of Indian nationals, especially from Kharkiv and Sumy. Prime Minister also spoke to the Prime Ministers of Romania, Slovak Republic, Hungary and the President of Poland to seek their support for the facilitation of transit of Indian nationals through their countries. External Affairs Minister was also in constant touch with his counterparts from Russia and Ukraine for the similar reasons. Foreign Secretary maintained the contact with the ambassadors of Russia and Ukraine in New Delhi, while the ambassadors in Kyiv and Moscow followed up in their respective capitals. Now answering you bit C. Indian embassy in Ukraine was temporarily relocated to Warsaw on March 13, 2022. With effect from May 17, 2022, Indian embassy in Ukraine has restored full operational with a reduced strength of consonance with requirement. Thank you. Hope I answered your question.
Thank you. अब अनुरोध करना चाहूंगी श्रीमती हृदय मोहिनी महांता से कि वो अपना प्रश्न पूछें।
Honorable Speaker Madam, I would like to request the Minister of Home Affairs to answer some of my queries. Will the Minister of Home Affairs be pleased to state A. the efforts made by the government to strengthen the Narcotics Control Bureau NCB? वैसे तो ये पूछना बेकार ही है, एक ऐसी सरकार created by the government to improve the technical and monitoring capability of NCB personnel and see if so the details thereof and the reasons therefore.
I request the Minister of Home Affairs to please reply to the query.
Honorable Speaker Madam, thank you for your questions. Answering point A, the Narcotics Control Bureau, that is the NCB, was established by the Government of India in exercise of powers conferred by subsection 3 of section 4 of the Narcotics, Drugs and Psychotropic Substances Act 1985 for the purpose of effectively preventing and combating abuse of narcotics, drugs and psychotropic substances and its illicit trade. The Government of India provides all administrative and financial support to the NCB for its smooth functioning and strengthening as required from time to time. Answering your point B and C, various steps to improve the technical and monitoring capability of NCB personnels are being undertaken, which are as detailed. Point 1. In-house training programs for various subjects like cryptocurrencies, darknet, digital surveillance, cybercrime information, cybercrime forensics, etc. were conducted to improve technical competence and monitoring capabilities of NCB officials. The details of the training programs are as detailed. In 2019, 24 training programs were conducted. In 2020, we had 20 training programs, and in 2021, we had again 24 training programs. In 2019, 85 officers were trained. In 2020, 149 were trained. And in 2021, we had 197. Point 2. NCB officials also attend various workshops and training programs conducted by various international organizations like the United Nations Office on Drugs and Crime, that is the UNODC, and the International Narcotics Control Bureau, that is the INCB, etc., to enhance their technical capabilities and update themselves with the latest advancements. Point 3. The officers of NCB are also nominated for various technical courses of similar nature conducted by other training institutions like the Central Bureau of Investigation Academy, which is there in Ghaziabad, Uttar Pradesh. We have the Central Academy for Police Training, which is there in Bhopal, Madhya Pradesh. And we have the National Forensics Science University, which is there in Gandhinagar, Gujarat. Our NCB officials work with utmost loyalty, sincerity and dedication. I appeal the opposition not to doubt the veracity of our officials. Please. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. And now I request the last questioner, Srimati Tamanna Acharya, to proceed with her question.
धन्यवाद महोदय. मैं विदेश मंत्री जी से आग्रह करना चाहती हूँ कि मेरे प्रश्नों के उत्तर दें. मंत्री जी जरा गौर फरमाइएगा. ए, the total amount of various kinds of short and long-term loans granted by the Union Government to the Government of Sri Lanka during the last 10 years, along with the terms and conditions. B, whether the government has extended any kind of help, including financial assistance, to the government of Sri Lanka to overcome the recent economic crisis in Sri Lanka. C, if so, the details thereof. And D, the steps taken, proposed to be taken to recover the loan from the government of Sri Lanka. आखिरी में अब सरकार से आशा है कि अब सरकार बाजत.
I request the Minister of External Affairs to please reply to the query.
Honorable Speaker Madam, answering your bit A to D, Government of India has extended 8 lines of credit. I repeat, 8 lines of credit to Sri Lanka amounting to $1,850.64 million in sectors including railways, infrastructure, defense, renewable energy, petroleum and fertilizers in the past 10 years. Under its neighborhood first policy,
government is committed to developing friendly and mutually beneficial relations with all its neighbors. In line with this policy, India continues to assist Sri Lanka in its economic development as also support it in overcoming its economic challenges. In development as also support it in all type of problems. In January 2022, India extended a US dollar of 400 million currency swap to Sri Lanka under the SAARC framework and deferred successive Asian Clearing Union settlements till July 6, 2022. A line of credit of US dollar 500 million was extended to Sri Lanka for importing fuel from India. In addition, India has extended a credit facility of US dollar 1 billion for the procurement of food, medicines and other essential items from India. Humanitarian assistance was also provided to Sri Lanka for gifting essential medicines worth INR 6 crores, 15,000 liters of kerosene oil and US dollar 55 million of LOC for procurement of urea fertilizer. Government of Tamil Nadu has contributed rice, milk powder and medicines worth about 16 million as a part of larger Indian assistance effort. Development assistance was also provided and under the lines of credit extended in accordance with Indian Development and Economic Assistance Scheme guidelines of Government of India. In accordance with these guidelines, the terms of these soft loans are transparent with low rate of interest, moratorium in principal repayment, long repayment period and inbuilt flexibility. In case of the delay in repayment by borrowing government, the issue is taken up bilaterally. Thank you. Hope I answered your question.
Thank you. Now the question hour comes
to an end. Honorable Speaker Madam, there has been a serious breach of privilege by the members of the ruling party. Days before, a serious and confidential issue relating to the foreign policy of India was discussed, which later was leaked into the media and now has become a chaotic debate. Honorable Speaker Madam, before the side puts forth any of their developmental projects and increments in the GDP, let them get to know about the rules, norms and decorum of the parliament and let them not make a shame of the people of whom they choose to be their representatives.
Honourable members, please maintain the decorum of the house. Honourable members,
Brush Sarkar nahi, Brush Sarkar nahi, Brush aapka soch hai, soch.
अरे हम तो उपजाते हैं, पकाते हैं और खाते हैं. आपके जैसा किसी का देश बेच कर गरीबों का खून चूस कर नहीं खाते हैं.
आप
श्रीमती निशा कुमारी, हैव यू गिवन नोटिस ऑफ दिस अर्लियर?
यस मैडम, आई हैव ऑलरेडी गिवन दिस नोटिस एट 10 AM दिस मॉर्निंग.
इट विल बी एग्जामिन्ड एंड यू विल कम टू नो अबाउट इट. नाउ पेपर्स टू बी लेड. Honorable Minister of Renewable Energy, Srimati Rupsha Roy, please.
Honorable Speaker, Madam, I beg to lay on the table copy of the papers related to reports by following. Identification of industrial sector promising for commercialization of solar energy. B. Market assessment of solar water heating in the Himalayan region. C. Delhi International Renewable Energy Conference.
Thank you. Honorable Minister of Tourism, Shriman Jayavardhan, please.
Honorable Speaker, Madam, with your permission, I would like to lay down the following. Annual report of the Indian Tourism Development Corporation Limited, New Delhi, for the year 2020-2021, along with the audited accounts and comments of the Controller and the Auditor General thereon, and also the annual reports for the year 2020-2021, along with audited accounts in respect to the Institute of Hotel Management, Catering Technology and Applied Nutrition, Bhubaneswar. Thank you.
Thank you. Now, Honorable Members, I have to make an important announcement. On my behalf and on behalf of the Honorable Members of the House, I have great pleasure in extending our warm and hearty welcome to the honorable members of the Japanese parliamentary delegation who are on a visit to India as our honored guests. We have among us the Honorable Minister of Foreign Affairs of Japan, Mr. Hayashi Yoshimasa. Mrs. Hayashi Yuko, spouse of the Honorable Minister of Foreign Affairs of Japan. Ms. Yoshikawa Yumi, Parliamentary Vice Minister for Foreign Affairs of Japan. It is a very high-powered delegation who arrived on Sunday, 11th December 2022. They are now seated in the special box. We wish them a happy and comfortable stay in our country. Now the Secretary General to report the message from the upper chamber of the Parliament. Secretary General, please.
Madam, I have to report the following message received from the Secretary of the Upper Chamber of the Parliament. The Central Universities Amendment Bill 2022, seeking to amend the Central Universities Act 2009, inter alia to provide for the establishment of Gati Shakti Vishwavidyalaya as a body corporate, has been passed by the Upper Chamber of the Parliament in the monsoon session, commenced on 18th July 2022 and is ready to be sent for the President's approval.
Secretary General to lay on the table a copy of the bill as passed by the upper chamber, please.
Madam, I lay on the table of the House the Central Universities Amendment Bill 2022 as passed by the upper chamber.
Thank you. Now the legislative bill to be introduced. Honorable Minister of Law, Srimati Kashish Fatima, to introduce the bill, please.
Speaker Madam, I beg to move for leave to introduce the new bill, the new bill, New Delhi International Arbitration Center Bill 2022.
The question is that leave be granted to introduce a bill further to amend the New Delhi International Arbitration Center Amendment Bill 2022. Those who are in favor will please say aye.
Aye.
Those who are against it will please say no.
No.
I think the ayes have it, the ayes have it, the ayes have it. Leave is granted.
Madam, I introduce the bill.
The bill will be considered in the next session of the Parliament. Now the House will take up consideration of the Women and Girl Child Prevention of Atrocities Bill. Women and Child Development Minister, please.
Honorable Speaker, Madam, I beg to move that the bill to provide for stringent punishment to curb atrocities against women and girl child to be taken into consideration. Madam, as we all know that in our society, despite reforms and awakening, it is unfortunate that women and girl child are still most vulnerable to various atrocities and violence. Teasing and molesting them, even at public place, need to be dealt with severity by providing deterrent punishment. Therefore, with a view to provide more stringent punishment to those abetting the act of atrocities against women, the government has brought forward this bill before the August House. Salient features of some of the important provisions of the bill are as follows. Any person who outrages the modesty of any woman shall be punished with imprisonment which shall not be less than 10 years and with a fine which may extend to rupees 10 lakh. Any person who commits the offence of rape against any woman or girl child shall be punished with death. The appropriate government shall, with the concurrence of concerned High Court, establish a special court in each district. Madam Speaker, I'm confident that all the members of this House, irrespective of their party affiliation, will welcome this bill wholeheartedly. I now move the Women and Child Development Prevention of Atrocities Bill to be taken into consideration.
Now let's hear some views on the topic. I request Srimati Samadrita Dolai to speak now, please.
Honorable Speaker, Madam, यदि हमारे सरकार ने महिलाओं के सुरक्षा हेतु पहले ही कठिन कदम उठाए होते या फिर कड़े कदम उठाए होते तो आज सैकड़ों भारतीय बेटियों को अपना बलिदान नहीं देना पड़ता। निर्भया रेप केस, हाथरस रेप केस, काठुआ रेप केस, अजमेर, दिल्ली और ना जाने क्या क्या। एक ऐसी सरकार जो महिलाओं के शोषण के लिए उनके कपड़ों को दोषी मानती है, उनसे हम क्या ही उम्मीद रख सकते हैं। मुझे बहुत ही प्रसन्नता हो रही है कि उन्होंने महिलाओं की सुरक्षा हेतु ये कदम उठाया। Honorable Speaker, Madam, women have always been subjected to molestation and sex abuse, but the incident of Guwahati, which attracted the media's attention, was a shocker. It was really a brutal act committed by 20 moral policing agents who think they can do anything that they wish to because they are males. India is not a best place to work or to move freely on the streets for the women. Honorable Speaker, Madam, it would have been better if the government would have taken some steps against the Khap Panchayats too. I wish the bill should have strict punishments for the self-proclaimed moral agents. I hereby support this bill and request the government to have female judges to hear the cases against the women. Thank you.
Thank you. I now request Shriman Jayavardhan to express his views.
फिर एक गुड़िया वहशी नजरों की शिकार हो गई। फिर एक गुड़िया वैसी नजरों की शिकार हो गई। फिर से देश, समाज और इंसानियत शर्मसार हो गई, शर्मसार हो गई, शर्मसार हो गई। Honorable Speaker, Madam, the number of cases of rapes against the girl, child and women in our country is increasing rapidly, and we can clearly see that there is no fear of law among the rapists. Hence, I think that it has become very necessary to provide strict punishments to the rapists in order to restore the women and the girl child in a respectable position in the society. And I would also like to suggest the Honorable Minister to have to look into in the matter of rehabilitation of the rape victims as well, and hence I support this bill. Thank you.
Now it is time for Srimati Shriporna Patra to express her views on the topic.
Madam Speaker, I thank you for giving me the opportunity to participate in this debate. I will not go into the different aspects of women atrocities because the elected members before me have already dealt with it at large. The only thing I would like to point out is that though this bill tries to cover one social evil, the fact remains that the cases of dowry and female feticide often involve female counterparts in it. We should seriously think on the issue how to empower the women, which is the only way to eradicate the mindset from the people of India. I hope the government understands my point of view. Social education is inoculation. Government should not be satisfied only by giving injections, but also should ensure that people are inoculated against the disease of women atrocities. I think there are more than enough provisions in our constitution and the Indian Penal Code to deal with the problem of women atrocities. So I don't think that another bill is needed for this. Hence, I strongly oppose the bill.
I now request Srimati Swayamprabha Bharadwaj to share her views.
Speaker, Madam, the violence against women is partly a result of gender relation that assumes man to be superior to woman. And much of the gender violence is considered normal and enjoys social sanction. Manifestation of violence includes physical aggression, burns, acts of attempted murder, sexual abuse and psychological violence through insult, humiliation, economic or emotional threats. I believe this bill will strongly deal with the domestic violence, and hence I support this bill. Thank you.
Now the Minister of Law, Srimati Kashish Fatima, please speak a few words.
Speaker, Madam, I thank you for giving me an opportunity to speak on the bill.
First of all, I would like to congratulate Honorable Minister for the bill. Madam, I would ask the Honorable Minister to consider the address of honor killing in the bill. Honor killing is different from dowry deaths, which is also a very common practice in India. People or family members decide to kill their daughters in the name of preserving their family honor. The most obvious reason for this practice to continue in India is because of the fact that caste system continues to be at its rigid best. So I request the Honorable Minister to address this issue. I support the bill.
This will be considered in the next session of the Parliament, and thank you for your opinion. Now I request Minister of Women and Child Development to speak, please.
Madam, I'm grateful to all the members who supported the bill. I'm also grateful to the members who gave their constructive criticism on it. With regard to the main suggestion, I would like to say that I agree that the whole problem of women atrocities are connected with the status of women in this country. But I think we as a national has reached a stage where we are committed to improve the status of women and give them equality in all fields. As far as honor killing is concerned, it is addressed in the bill. One of the main suggestions that has been given to me is about the question of female judges. Madam Speaker, I'd like to aware the House that we have made provisions for it in the bill as well. As regard to the main point raised by the Honourable Member, that the crime is bailable, there seems to have been some misunderstanding, because for any crime where the punishment is for 7 years along with imprisonment for death penalty, it is automatically non-bailable as per the IPC provisions. I hope I've answered most of the questions raised by the members in the course of my speech. I once again thank you for your support and seed your cooperation in implementing this measure. I request the House to pass the bill.
Thank you. Now the question is that the Women and Girl Child Prevention of Atrocities Bill, for matters connected therewith, be taken into consideration. Those who are in favor will please say aye.
Aye.
Those who are against it will say no.
No.
I think the ayes have it, the ayes have it, the ayes have it. The motion is adopted. Now clause by clause consideration. Now the question is that clause 2-11 stand part of the bill. Those who are in favor will please say aye.
Aye.
Those who are against it will please say no.
No.
I think the ayes have it, the ayes have it, the ayes have it. The motion is adopted. Clause 2-11 stands part of the bill. Now the question is that clause 1, the enacting formula and title stand part of the bill. Those who are in favor will please say aye.
Aye.
Those who are against it will please say no.
No.
I think the ayes have it, the ayes have it, the ayes have it. The motion is adopted. Minister of Women and Child Development, please.
Madam, I move the bill to be passed.
Motion moved that the bill is passed. Those who are in favor will please say aye. Those who are against it, please say no.
No.
I think the ayes have it, the ayes have it, the ayes have it. Motion is adopted. Now today's session was very fruitful. The session is adjourned till the next date. Thank you. The program now comes to an end. Thank you all for your active participation. Thank you.
Now the program of Youth Parliament is finished. I would like everyone to stand up for the national anthem. Sorry for the inconvenience. Now I would like program coordinator Dr. Kalinga Ketki for the vote of thanks.
Silence, please. थोड़ा सा एक मिनट फॉर्मल वोट ऑफ थैंक्स मैं कहां से शुरू करूंगा कहां खत्म करूंगा मुझे खुद समझ में नहीं आ रहा. इट्स अ रियल फैक्ट दैट हमारे आरआई स्टूडेंट के अंदर इतना काबिलियत भरी है जो कि उन्होंने पार्लियामेंट जो दिल्ली में है ना उसको यहां पे रीजनल कॉलेज न्यू ऑडिटोरियम में उतार दिए. खुद प्रिंसिपल इतना तारीफ करके गए और एसकेडी सर और आप सब भी आप खुद प्रोग्राम देखे हैं. एंड बीइंग ए मैन ऑफ पॉलिटिकल साइंस आई हैव ऑलरेडी अटेंडेड द सेशन आज गेस्ट वाटन इन पार्लियामेंट दिल्ली व्हेनेवर आई वाज देयर इन जेएनयू बट दिस सेशन वाज नॉट लेस देन रादर दिस सेशन वाज बेटर than the real parliament system is going there inside the parliament house, New Delhi. The way all the participants of RI, quote unquote, all the participants presented their assignment, really it is far, 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 far better than the real ministers of our country. And the way they conducted this session with full of discipline. But you see, not only in our parliament, but other parliaments also, how the members of the parliament are fighting with each other. But in that way, our students finished this session with full of decency and discipline. Anyway, now I'll proceed towards my formal vote of thanks. I'm very much thankful to all none other than our Honorable Principal Professor P.C. Agrawal sir for his unconditional support and constant inspiration and unending cooperation to conduct this kind of program in this institute. Without his support, you know, my dear friends, my dear participants, that it is simply impossible to conduct any kind of program in this institute. So that's why I am very much, I am highly thankful to our Honorable Principal Professor P.C. Agrawal sir. Next, I am very much thankful to our Dean of Instructions, Professor S.K. Das sir, for his cooperation and support to organize this program. I am very much thankful to other faculty members, those who are present here, and even I am very much, my special thanks goes to Dr. Bijapal Jadhav, who is sitting here, and he is a man who is always taking personal interest to send children from hostel to institute to attend the program. Thank you, Bindapalji. I am very much thankful to the administrative officers of the institute. I am very much thankful to the store officer. I am very much thankful to the section officer of establishment committee. I am also very much thankful to CNW section for their support to organize this program. At the same time, I am extremely thankful to the staff of our ICT studio. Panda Babu, Saraj Babu, though Saraj Babu is not here, he is on leave today, but on the 4th, he coordinated the thing very perfectly. And I am very much thankful to Saraj Babu, and at the same time, I am very much thankful to Tarun Sahu, who also helped a lot. But my special thanks goes to Gyan, who is sitting before us. Before starting this program, we were not having this ghee and this, what is that called? Yeah. And Gyan went to another bazaar very immediately and took all these items. Thank you, Gyan. Now, the time has come to say thank you to our dear participants. Really, you have done a marvelous job. Because this is the first time we are having this kind of program in this institute, quote unquote, first time in the history of RI Bhubaneswar. And I don't think that all the RIs will have this kind of program or had this kind of program. This is completely new. And that shows that how the audience are interested. I don't think that besides this program, in any other program, the students are sitting up to this time, up to our, to the end of this program. People are not sitting with lots of enthusiasm. But today you see, students are sitting there. That means the program is very, very successful. For this grand success of this program, the entire credit goes to our participants and my dear students. The participants, they took a lot of pain, because you know, to organize any kind of program, it's really very painful. If you want to take your friend to another bazaar event, you have to give something. Then I'll give Gupchup, I'll give this, I'll give that, then you come and join with us so that you can go to Anand Bazar and you can give me company. Then people are going. Then in this situation, you see, organizing this kind of activities, it is next to impossible. Because organizing at a time, 42 students are taking part in these events. And the entire program was coordinated by none other than your friend. She is none other than Punya Salila, popularly known as Punya. She took a lot of pain to organize this program very systematically. For last fortnight, or more than that, she has been doing the thing very constantly. Today I told something, then she cried also. I felt very unhappy about it. I'm sorry for that. Right? Because I asked her that tomorrow we are going to have a grand program. The commissioner of Bhubaneswar BMC, Amrita Bijay Amrita Kulange, IS, will be the chief guest here on the stage tomorrow at 3 p.m. And I approached her that you do this anchoring job. Then she said that, sir, I'm having some other assignment, I'll go to my hometown. Then I post her, no, you have to do it. Then she cried, nothing. Anyway, she took a lot of interest, and whenever they were the student in their school, they organized this kind of youth parliament. She was there in KV. Then you know, very interesting thing, their school stood third in the national level for conducting this kind of youth parliament. That was KB. KB? KB? KB to Bhubaneswar. And for last couple of months, principal was talking to me that you, why you are not organizing this kind of program, youth parliament. Then I was not saying anything else, but the thing is, I didn't know even how to conduct this big event. That's why I was not taking very interest about. But whenever I heard about that their school stood third in the national level, and she was also in that team, then I requested that you organize, then we are here to support you. Then all the, even if I am very happy that past year students, jo stage ke upar aane ke liye, matlab, trembling karte hain, isme se kisna hai, past year student kitna hai? Dekho, past year, Jaivardhan, ye Susmita, और क्या 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 फर्स्ट ईयर कौन कौन है? तो फर्स्ट ईयर स्टूडेंट, आप देखो आपके सामने फर्स्ट ईयर जो कि स्टेज आने से पहले 10 बार सोचते हैं चढ़ेंगे ना. तो इसलिए माय डियर फ्रेंड्स, व्हेनेवर आई एम टेकिंग क्लास आल्सो आई एम सेइंग दैट व्हेनेवर एंड व्हेयरएवर यू आर गेटिंग चांस टू कम अप ऑन द स्टेज, डोंट मिस द चांस. दिस इज द प्लेस वेयर यू कैन योर कॉन्फिडेंस. आप देखो फर्स्ट ईयर का बच्चे, और ये रिकॉर्डिंग अभी है, ये अभी यूट्यूब में जाएगा, ये अभी मिनिस्ट्री में जाएगा, एंड योर पेरेंट्स कैन ऑल्सो सी, योर रिलेटिव्स कैन सी, एंड दैट शोज दैट हाउ यू कैन बिल्ड योर कॉन्फिडेंस, योर कैरियर. सो दैट्स व्हाई आई एम वेरी मच थैंकफुल टू वन एंड ऑल दोज हु हैव पार्टिसिपेटेड इन कंडक्टिंग दिस यूथ पार्लियामेंट ऑन 14th December 2022. और इसमें से ऐसे हो भी सकता है आज के बाद, इसमें से जैसे प्रिंसिपल साहब बोल के गए, किसको पता कि इसमें से कोई देश का आईन बनाने के लिए कामयाब नहीं होंगे? किसी को नहीं पता. बराक ओबामा, लिसन, बराक ओबामा जब पॉलिटिक्स करने के लिए निकले, उनका मिसेस बोले मिचेल कि अगर आप पॉलिटिक्स करोगे, आई विल द फर्स्ट पर्सन टू टेक पॉइजन. लिसन, बराक ओबामा द फॉर्मर प्रेसिडेंट ऑफ स्टेट्स, जब राजनीति करने के लिए उतरे, उनका मिसेस बोले अगर आप राजनीति करेंगे देन मैं जहर खा लूंगी. और ये बात यहां तक गई कि डिवोर्स तक बात गई कि मैं डिवोर्स कर दूंगी. बट वही बराक ओबामा द मोस्ट सक्सेसफुल प्रेसिडेंट अमेरिका का 2 times. दैट शोज दैट इफ यू आर हैविंग टैलेंट देन यू कैन गो अहेड, नोबडी कैन स्टॉप यू. दैट्स व्हाई आई एम टेलिंग, इफ समबडी इज ही सिटिंग हियर, आई डोंट नो, वी डोंट नो हु ही विल बी, शी विल बी. If somebody will be there in the parliament or assembly, legislative assembly, then they can make law for the country. Because you know that parliament is the highest law making authority in a country. So that's why I wish all the best. And once again, I also convey my best thanks to all of you. My thanks goes to my dear friends. Without audience, it is simply impossible to conduct any program. So that's why I'm very, very, very much extremely thankful to all my student teachers for your patience. And on enjoying this program at the fullest length. So thank you very much to all of you. And I hope that in near future we'll have this kind of program and you all try to take participate in any program. Don't miss. Again, I could repeat, that whenever and wherever you are getting chance to come on the stage, don't miss the chance. So that's why I'm very much thankful to all of you, and I'm also very much thankful to Speaker Madam. She performed very well. In fact, all the people that performed very well, but she was doing the job like a professional one. Anyway, thank you for your attention. Thanks all the ministers, thanks all the members, thank the minister from Bihar, right? And thank you all of you once again. And इससे पहले मैं एक small announcement आप सबके लिए refreshment है. आप discipline के साथ आप एक एक करके वहाँ पे जाके refreshment ले लीजिएगा और यहाँ पे जो लोग हैं आप इसके बाद लीजिएगा. Thank you once again. Thanks a lot. Thank you.